It is my pleasure to introduce each of you to Dr. Ann Partridge, who is Vice Chair of Medical Oncology at Dana-Farber, founder and director of Young and Strong, the program for young adults with breast cancer, director of the Adult Survivorship Program, as well as a professor of medicine at Harvard Medical School.
Thanks, Catherine. And as we start off, I want to say a profound thanks to you and to Sarah and to the whole team at Dana-Farber for making this happen for our patients who are engaged today. And then, of course, we're taping these, so they will be on our website and available in the future for those who come on late or can't make it. Without further ado, I'm really, really, really excited to introduce my friend, who I've known for many years now in the cancer survivorship, cancer advocacy space, Samantha Watson, better known as Sam. So Sam is nationally recognized as a thought leader in the fields of young adult cancer and financial toxicity in particular. She herself is a two-time cancer survivor. She was diagnosed with Ewing sarcoma, which is a cancer of the bones at the age of 21, and then subsequently got a secondary, which means the treatment caused myelodysplastic syndrome, or basically a cancer of the bone marrow, a ripe old age of 23, so 2 years later. Fortunately, Sam has done extraordinarily well, and she moved from patient to patient advocate, and she has turned what has been such a challenge at a young age and turned it into a triumph, and she's served the young adult cancer community now for almost 20 years. Samantha is the founder of the Samfund, a nonprofit organization designed to supporting young adults in their financial recovery from cancer. And now this is a program within the Expect Miracles Foundation. And Sam, I'm sure, will speak to that herself. She's here tonight, and she's going to discuss, among other things, how she handled the many obstacles and challenges of dealing with cancer at a young age. She is fantastic. I always love listening to Sam. And at the end, after she talks, we'll have not so much a Q&A. We'll answer your questions, but we're going to have a really good conversation. And try and kind of, you know, really try and get at what people want to hear more about from Sam, who's kind of walked the walk of a young cancer survivor. And while it's not breast cancer, so many of the things that Sam has experienced, both herself and then through her charitable and just amazing advocacy work, really resonate for young breast cancer survivors and patients. So Sam, whatever you want me to call you tonight. I'm not your mother, so I'm calling you Sam. Take it away, please.
Dr. Partridge, thank you so much for that very wonderful introduction, and to all of you at Young and Strong. Thank you for inviting me to do this. I miss the days when we could do this in person. It's a little bit weird to be getting very personal with a screen, and I wish I could see everyone's faces and interact, but hopefully towards the end, we'll be able to do that. And for now, I just want to welcome all of you. Thank you for joining me tonight and for being willing to listen to me talk for a while. So tonight's topic is really about the importance of owning our stories, and all of us who are on tonight, who are listening to this recording later, have one thing in common, right? Whether you are newly diagnosed or currently in treatment, or a loved one or a caregiver of someone who's living with a breast cancer history, cancer's impacted all of us. Cancer has made its way into all of our stories, right? And I think that what's so important, especially at those moments when we feel so powerless over what's happening to us, is to remember that we actually have a lot of control over how our story gets told. And so I want to spend some time sharing my story. And because it's been 20, I always have to do the math, almost 23 years since my first diagnosis, because I can't possibly be that old, but 23 years since my first diagnosis, I've gained a lot of insight, both in my own personal life and also through working with thousands of young adult survivors across the country. And so I just want to share some of what I've learned, and hopefully it will be helpful to you as you claim your story. And, you know, as Dr. Partridge said, there will be time for questions and discussion at the end. And I hope you'll stick around for that, because in any way that I can be helpful to you, I am more than happy to do that. The one thing that I do want to say before I start is that in the interest of time, I'm going to try and tackle a lot. And so a lot of it is going to be very broad and pretty quick. It's just because it's very hard to cram 20 years into 40 minutes. So if there is something you're curious about, if there's something I touch on but I don't talk enough about that resonates with you and you want to learn more, just go ahead and ask. And I'm happy to do that. So just by way of quick background, I grew up in Manhattan and I lived in the city. Both my parents live there. They're divorced. My mom was an oncology nurse at Memorial Sloan Kettering. And when I was 15, we moved from Manhattan to the woods of Vermont. And I think that if I could see your faces, I would see everybody sort of cringing a little bit, because moving from the city to the suburb, not even the suburbs, to a rural area in Vermont at that particular age was very, very challenging. But it was also wonderful. It was a great place to be up in Vermont. When I graduated from high school, I went to Boston to attend Brandeis University. And without knowing it, that's sort of where my cancer story began. So about once a year, starting right at the end of high school, I had this recurring knee pain. Nobody could explain it. They did a zillion tests. And in the end, doctors sort of decided, because nothing else made sense, that it was probably bursitis. And they would give me a shot of cortisone and send me on my way. My senior year of college, it happened again. The pain came back. I went through a lot of tests, and it was actually my primary care physician who was in Vermont. He was an allergist by training. He recommended a bone scan. I didn't know what that meant. My mom sort of managed all of the details behind the scenes, and I went down to New York to get a bone scan. And shortly after, I was diagnosed with Ewing sarcoma, which, as Dr. Partridge says, is a bone cancer diagnosed about 300 times a year and typically in boys under the age of 20. So not only had I never heard of Ewing's, I didn't actually even know anyone else that had had cancer. And I want to pause just for a second to acknowledge the incredible privilege that I had, because my mom was an oncology nurse at one of the leading cancer institutions in the world. And that immediately sort of offered me access, not only access to care, but access to great care. And for those of you who are on tonight, if you're being treated at Dana-Farber, you were treated at Dana-Farber, the same is true, right? We have this incredible privilege of getting the best care in the world, which is something not everybody has. And so I always feel that it's important to acknowledge that privilege and also to recognize that it's not something that I take for granted. So the other thing was that since I had grown up in Manhattan, I had the best support network around me. And so when I was diagnosed with Ewing's, my friends were there, my family was there. This was December of 1999, and we were surrounded all the time by people in the family room, by people coming to visit, by people, you know, coming to see us wherever we were staying. And that was pretty huge at that time to have that support. And so when I got back to school, I went through about, I don't know, 8 or 9 months of pretty intense chemo. I had a 12-hour surgery because the cancer was in my leg and I had to relearn to walk and do a ton of PT. And finally, they said, okay, you can go back to school. And because I had been in the middle of my senior year when I was diagnosed, I went back as a second semester senior. And I was so excited to be back there with my friends and to be graduating and to be doing the things that I felt a normal 23-year-old person was supposed to be doing. But I was sick all the time and I was tired all the time. And I didn't really have anybody that I could talk to about it because I had lost several of my friends that I'd gone through treatment with. And so while I was surrounded by people that loved me, I was not surrounded by people who understood me in the way that I needed them to. And that was a really hard thing to navigate. And so about a month before I graduated from college, they decided to look a little bit further because my counts had been down. I hadn't been feeling great for a while. I had a bone marrow biopsy actually the day before my 23rd birthday, which I remember because I said to them, I spent my 22nd birthday in the hospital. I'm not spending 23 in the hospital. I went out, I drank a lot of margaritas with my family and went in the next day to get the diagnosis of secondary myelodysplastic syndrome, which was essentially an early form of leukemia. And so this time I was not sure what that meant. When I was diagnosed with Ewing's, I had never heard of it, which meant I didn't know enough to be as scared as I should have been. When I was diagnosed with myelodysplastic syndrome and told I needed a bone marrow transplant, my thoughts went immediately to the only person that I had known who had had a bone marrow transplant, and he had not survived more than 6 months. And so my frame of reference going into my treatment the second time was very, very different. But I had a bone marrow transplant in August of 2001, and I spent about 3 months in the hospital. So for those of you trying to do the math, it was a very surreal time because it was also during the time of 9/11. And so there was so much happening around me, and I sat sort of at the center of all of it and felt disconnected from all of it. I was in a hospital room. I watched my friends graduate from college. I watched my friends go on dates and get their first apartments. And I wasn't even sure I was going to make it out of the hospital. And so I had to go in every day for tests. And then I had to go in every week, turned into every month. And about a year later, because with the transplant, with the bone marrow transplant, I assume the same is still true. It's very much a waiting game. It's very much a numbers game. So we counted to day 30 and we counted to day 100. And then when I hit the year mark and everything was basically stable, my doctor said, okay, go live your life. Come back in a couple months. And that was one of the first moments that I realized I didn't know where to go. I had graduated from school because while they were looking for a bone marrow donor, I went back to school and I graduated. I hadn't yet started working. And I didn't really have a safety net under me because I had left sort of at the end of one chapter and hadn't had the chance to start another one. And I felt incredibly isolated because the remaining friends that I had that I went through treatment with had all passed away by that point. I had a very small handful of people that I held on very, very tight to, but none of whom lived in Boston. And so I was sort of faced with this experience of needing to navigate life as a young adult with cancer without any sort of guidebook. I had to figure out what my story was without really anything more than Lance Armstrong's book, which had one chapter about survivorship. And so I really struggled at that time. I was living with a roommate. I had a friend who helped me get a job, and they were such wonderful supports to me. But I didn't know anyone else who spoke my language or who looked like me or who had scars that looked like mine. And I really had to sort of forge a path without anyone sort of clearing the way for me before that. And so I started to meet some young adults. It was actually at a conference at Dana-Farber in 2003 that I met young adults with cancer. It was the first time I found my people. And the conference was called I'm Too Young for This. And I remember that Doug Ullman, who's now at Pelotonia, was the keynote speaker. I don't remember the people that I met. I don't remember the workshops that I attended, but I remember the feeling of being there and feeling finally like I had found my community and that I needed to do something within this community to pay it forward and to be able to move forward through my own cancer story. And so I left that day feeling so fired up, and I wanted to essentially do a fundraiser. That's all I wanted to do. I had a lot of musical friends in school. I figured we could do a fundraiser and donate the proceeds to an organization that was helping young adults specifically after treatment. Because to me, what it felt like was that when I finished treatment and cancer was not at the forefront for me and for everybody around me, it felt like I got pushed off a cliff. And so I didn't want other young adults to feel that way. There was one other thing that happened in that time that really informed what I did next and everything that I've done since. And that was about 2000 and probably two or three, I received a bill in the mail for $275,000. I actually found the bill when we moved recently because I wondered if maybe I had exaggerated that number over time, $275,000. And it had to do with insurance wanting me to go to a different hospital far away where I didn't have support. The doctor in no uncertain terms told me I was not going to survive. And so suffice it to say, I did not choose to go there. And I went back to Sloan Kettering, but insurance wasn't going to pay for it. $275,000, and I was not even 25 years old. Now, luckily, my mom is an oncology nurse, and she had been working in Vermont at that time, but her employer had given her the time off to be my caregiver. And so she wasn't getting paid, but she stayed on our health insurance. And so that was not a concern. And she had the time to advocate for me. So we got this bill in the mail, and she spent 2 years fighting our insurance system over it, insurance company, excuse me. And when they would deny it, she would appeal it, and they would deny it again, and she would appeal it. And she took it all the way to the top levels of the state. And ultimately, after 2 years, they dropped it. But it was very clear to me then, and certainly as I started to meet more young adults, that without her and without that effort, I would have been bankrupt before I was 25. And so not only did I want to do something to support young adults after treatment, but I wanted to do something to support them financially, because when you don't have those supports in place and you can't work because of cancer treatment and any number of other reasons why $275,000 is an absurd amount of money to face when you're 25 or any age, I just wanted to help young adults pay their bills. And when we did some research and found out that there weren't any organizations that existed at that time, I started one. And I wish that I could tell you that I had a strategic vision or I had a business plan even. I had nothing. I was 25. Speaking Spanish was my only job skill. And I didn't know what I was doing. But I surrounded myself with really smart people. And I wasn't afraid to fail. And that was the first time since I had been diagnosed with cancer that I felt this spark of confidence again. Not necessarily that I would succeed at what I was doing, but that I wasn't afraid to try it. And that was a really empowering feeling. And so over time, the Samfund grew and we raised money and we helped young adults pay their bills. And we covered things like medical bills and living expenses and groceries and car payments and all sorts of things. And what started to happen in that time, which I didn't realize then, but has sort of made sense ever since, is that there were two really important conversations emerging nationally and globally. One was about young adult cancer, because I don't have to tell any of you what a unique experience it is to be a young adult who's treated not just clinically, but it's a unique experience socially and psychologically and financially and in every way. And so finally, people were starting to talk about this. It was young adult cancer was starting to be recognized as a legitimate and underserved segment of the cancer population. The other conversation that was starting to happen was about financial toxicity, because I probably also don't have to tell any of you that not only do we not like to talk about illness, but we really don't like to talk about money. And so when those two things intersect, it's a conversation nobody wants to have. And as a result, you get a bill in the mail for $275,000 because nobody told you to expect it. And there's no way to prepare for it, manage it. And most people will go bankrupt. And so when these two conversations started emerging, we were well positioned to participate and to share what we had learned. And so the Samfund, not so much me personally, the Samfund got recognized as a thought leader. And we got these opportunities to collaborate and present and learn from everybody who was in this space and finally start to not just put a Band-Aid on it by providing grants, but start to brainstorm solutions. And over time, the Samfund was growing. At our biggest, we were about $700,000 budget, but the need was growing exponentially. And we really struggled with how to keep up with that. And so in July of 2019, we merged with an organization called Expect Miracles Foundation, which is also Boston-based. And we essentially picked up our Samfund programs and put them right back down, because the team at Expect Miracles was equally committed to supporting young adults, really wanted to provide direct service, because historically Expect Miracles has provided research funding to Dana-Farber and to Sloan Kettering. And that is critically important, obviously, but they wanted to do something more directly with patients and families as well. And so our program fit really neatly into what they wanted to do. Expect Miracles was a much bigger organization than the Samfund was, and it just worked. And so Samfund programs actually are growing and thriving. Not only have we given out over $3 million in Samfund grants now, but we've also developed programs around financial literacy, medical debt negotiation. We provide community through social media and other, used to be in person. Now it's mostly online, like everything. But I'm incredibly proud of the partnership that we created, because it enabled all of us to do more. And so the quick end to that sort of chapter of the story is that I decided, after many, many years, truthfully, of struggling with the overload of cancer and the overwhelm of cancer, that it was time for me to move out of my staff role, but I didn't want to step away entirely. So in July of this year, I joined the board of Expect Miracles. I left my staff position so I could still sort of be involved peripherally. And I'm still involved in different projects within this group, because it is where my heart is. It's where my heart will always be. But thinking about cancer 24/7 just took away from my ability to be more present in other areas of my life. And so it's a really good place to be. So I want to sort of take a step back now from the details of my story. That's sort of how it went chronologically, excuse me, to share some of the things that I've learned along the way. So one of the things I learned really quickly, and it was not so much being in my early 20s, although that certainly mattered, but it was being newly out of treatment at that time, was that context really matters. Finding a place for cancer in my story really mattered. And interactions like going on dates or going on job interviews or just everyday social interactions, they weren't normal. They, as a young adult cancer survivor, they were loaded. And I felt like every word that I said would inform how people saw me. And I was so self-conscious about so many things. And so one of the things I also learned was that the way I shared my story would determine how people responded to it. So in other words, what you say matters, but how you say it matters even more. And so I know there's a lot of terminology around patients and survivors and thrivers, and whatever word works for you, claim it, right? There's nobody that can argue with that, and everybody makes different choices. But if you think about yourself as a victim and that's how you present it, that's how people are going to see you. And so I really quickly had to figure out how to fit cancer into my story and how to start to sort of claim control over how that story got told. So a really interesting thing has happened. I am back in Vermont by choice. I am not 15 anymore. I have not moved from Manhattan, but my husband and my kids, who are now 12 and 10, and I will tell you about them in a little bit, we moved to Vermont 4 days after I left my job. And when I hear myself say it and when I talk to people about it, I know that it sounds like I was having a midlife crisis. In reality, it has felt like exactly the opposite. It has been an incredible experience over the last few months, not just to be up here where things are a little bit slower and a little bit quieter, but to live close to my mom again and to offer a better learning environment for my kids and just to be in a quieter space after the chaos of the last few years. And what's interesting to me now is that, again, I'm in this situation in a new place. I'm not working in cancer, and so it doesn't naturally come up in conversation, but I'm in this place again where now I need to choose whether to disclose my cancer story. And it's been very interesting to sort of observe the conversations and to take stock of how I feel about it now versus how this experience went when I was 23 and 24. And, you know, for me, it's not about being self-conscious anymore or worrying about how someone's perception of me is going to affect me personally or professionally. The most interesting part for me is that it feels irrelevant. And I was public with my story very early on. And so I never had that choice to sort of leave it in the background. And now I can choose to do that. And sometimes I do, and sometimes I don't. I have friends up here that I've known since I lived here in high school, and they obviously know my story and my history. People that I meet for the first time don't. And so I have to decide, is there a purpose to telling them? You know, does it come up? I mean, right now my focus is so much on being a mom that it doesn't really matter so much anymore. I think when I was in my early 20s and I was going through this for the first time, being finished with treatment and sort of being out in the world as an independent young adult cancer survivor was such a scary experience, because I went from being in treatment with the focus on me at all times and looking like a cancer patient so people could sort of understand my story even before they talked to me about it, to then trying to blend in and trying to sort of pass, I guess, is what it felt like as a normal young adult. And I felt like people could see right through me. I mean, I have plenty of scars that are easy enough to cover up if I choose to. And I always have chosen to, especially when I was younger. But I felt like people could see my fears, and they could see my mental health struggles, and they could see my infertility struggles. And so what I meant when I said that these interactions were loaded was exactly that. There was so much riding on disclosure. And at the same time, it's a really heavy burden to carry. And so, you know, I never gave myself the chance to keep cancer in the background and to be anonymous about it. And now in my mid 40s, going through this sort of again at a very different life stage has been just pretty amazing, actually, to be able to reinvent this story as I go. And so I just wanted to share, I know we have a couple more minutes before we want to open it up, but I just wanted to share some, I don't like to call it advice because I don't know that I've necessarily done things right or wrong. I've done them in a way that's genuine to me. But I, as I said earlier, I have hindsight on this and I have insight into this and from my own story and also from the many, many young adults we've talked to over the years. And so I just want to share the things that I think are really important when you start to think about either claiming or changing or reclaiming your cancer story. So I talked a little bit about being mindful about how you share information and the tone of your voice and your body language, right? When you're explaining to someone that you've had cancer. But I think it's equally important to be mindful of why you're sharing it, because that the answer to that question, your why, will be your North Star. And the answer to that question might change. The reason why I was sharing things when I was 25 is different than when I was 35, is different now that I'm almost 45, and has always sort of helped to guide me, because if I'm crystal clear on what purpose sharing my cancer story serves me and how it might serve other people, then it just has always made me more comfortable in my own skin and in sharing this. So I have a couple just examples that I wanted to share with you. So when I was about 23 or 24, I was in my first ever job, really. I mean, I had had jobs in college, but this was my first like drive to work, get a nice clothes like we used to pre-COVID, real office job. And in hindsight, they probably knew a lot more about my cancer history than I thought, because my hair was about this long. I can't remember if I was still on crutches, but I still was definitely recovering physically. But I hadn't told anybody. I worked with one good friend, but I hadn't told anybody my cancer story. And then in about the second week that I was working there, I got an email from Eli. Now, Eli was my bone marrow donor. And at that time, we had exchanged, actually, to totally date myself, we exchanged faxes. They faxed my information to him and his information to me. And all I knew was his name and that he lived in St. Louis. But in that second week of work, he emailed me and he sent me a picture. And I started shrieking because Eli, the man who had saved my life, had a face. And I saw his wife, Christine. And it just brought everything to a new level. And I started shrieking. And so of course, everybody around me came running into my office. And in that moment, I had to decide what to do with it. And I said, okay, you may not know this about me, but I had cancer and I had a bone marrow transplant. And this is my bone marrow donor. And oh my God, I can see his face. And because I was so happy about it, and because it was such a happy reason to be talking about something pretty unhappy, that's how everyone responded. They surrounded me with exactly the reaction that I was hoping for, which was just being excited and feeling grateful and everything positive. And so that was sort of accidental on my part, or just, I couldn't help it. That was the reaction that I had, but it was genuine. And they came in and they supported me and then started asking questions. And it opened up a lot of conversations from then on. So, you know, similarly, I'm sure we could spend an entire night talking about dating stories, I'm sure. I will keep it brief, but just know that there are many, 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 and they're hilarious and ridiculous, and it's just part of it, right? But when I was dating and I was living in Boston and I was trying to sort of figure out when to bring cancer up, certainly first date felt a little soon, but I didn't want to do it, you know, too late when someone was already in a relationship with me and et cetera. But I sort of experimented a little bit, and I definitely had a date one time that shut down completely when I mentioned the word cancer. And that was awkward and also very short. So that was one experience. And I think one thing that I learned from that is that I had to prepare myself for it. I mean, you hope that people are good people. I don't think that he meant anything horrible by it. I think he probably freaked out because most people don't go on a first date with someone who's had cancer before they're 25. But I wouldn't have been able to go out on that date until I was ready for that sort of reaction, because that could have crushed me. If I was still feeling so uncomfortable and so self-conscious and so worried that, you know, I was less than or damaged goods or all of the things that were sort of happening immediately after treatment, then that interaction would have crushed me. instead, I could kind of laugh about it because, you know, he was, I don't think he was a jerk. I just think he was uninformed, if we want to be nice about it. In all fairness, I think it was probably as uncomfortable for him. But then there were also several dates that followed when I was involved in volunteer activities, or I was, you know, participating in a cancer event, or once I had started the Samfund and was talking about that. And naturally the question was, oh, how'd you get involved in that? Or what made you want to do that? And then cancer became the background to the story. I said, oh, well, I had cancer a few years ago and really wanted to give back. And so this is what I'm doing in order to do that. And it was from a much more empowered place. I was excited about the work that I was doing. And so I think 201, people responded in exactly the way that I had hoped, which was just to be interested and to see it as a positive. And so, you know, when we talk about sort of why we're sharing and how we're sharing, there's a very big difference between I had cancer and sort of crawling inside yourself and, you know, clearly being uncomfortable about it. And I do this work that I'm passionate about because I had cancer and I feel like I just need to pay it forward, right? Those are two very different conversations about exactly the same topic. I mean, ultimately what I learned is that people were not allowed to feel negatively about it if I didn't myself. And so that was a really important lesson. And professionally, you know, as I said, I was public about my story very early because I didn't have any other job skills to validate what I was doing at the Samfund. I started the Samfund because I was a young adult with cancer who had some really, really big bills. And that's what validated my work. And so I went back to school eventually to get an MBA in nonprofit management so that I could actually learn how to run an organization. But before that, I didn't really have anything to stand on. And so it was my personal story that brought people in, that made them, you know, support our work in those early years, especially, and who believed that I might not know how to do it, but I knew what I wanted to do and I would figure out a way to get it done. So, you know, over time, my why has changed and that's okay. Where you are tonight, right now, is not where you will always be. And it's okay if your story changes with you. It's expected. It's good if it does. And you should be really proud of it. So another thing that I wanted to share in sort of this same area is thinking about why you share and how you share, also sort of where you share. So when I was diagnosed and treated in 1999, 2000, 2001, there was no social media. And there's good to that and there's bad to that. I think I didn't have an easy way to connect with other young adults and families who were dealing with this in the same way that so many opportunities exist today virtually. But I also didn't have to worry about someone sharing my story publicly before I was ready to. And so, you know, as I talk to my kids a lot about the internet, because it, especially social media sites, they feel so private. It's all public and it's all permanent. And so being mindful of where you share information and how you're sharing it really, really matters, because what might serve you well now might not serve you well in 10 years or 20 years or 1 year, and you can't take it back. So just be mindful of that, that the decisions that you make now probably are going to be around long after you want them to be. So whatever you choose to share, do it with discretion, excuse me. And in a similar note, find your people. And when you find your people, you hold on tight to them. So I talked about the feeling of being at this conference at Dana-Farber and finding my community of people. The upside to social media absolutely is connection. And the people who know you the best are going to help you claim your story. And it doesn't just have to be fellow breast cancer survivors. It doesn't have to be fellow caregivers and loved ones, although certainly those connections are incredibly valuable. But surround yourself with the people who support you unconditionally, and they'll be the ones that help you write this chapter of your narrative, right? One other thing that I was thinking about recently is that I was interviewed many, many years ago, and it was at a time, I think it was for one of the Live Strong books, and it was at a time when cancer was just at the forefront of everything, 24/7. And they pulled out one quote, and I didn't even remember saying it, but I think it's especially relevant to share tonight, which is that cancer is a chapter in my story. It's not the whole book. And when you're right in the throes of it and, you know, immediately finished with sort of the acute in clinic everyday stage of things, or treatment stage, surgery, whatever it might be, it feels like it is the whole book. Cancer is a chapter. Cancer may be a theme throughout multiple chapters, but it is a chapter. It is not your whole story. And so finally, the last thing before we open it up for a discussion, be genuine. My story is different from all of your stories. All of your stories are different from everyone else's stories. And what makes them incredible is that they are ours alone, right? I believe very, very deeply in operating with integrity, in sharing things in a way that I'm proud of. And, you know, all of us have been through something that most people probably can't even imagine. And all of you, all of us should stand tall knowing that we've lived through something amazing. And to be able to move forward through that is amazing in its own right. So I'm not a huge fan of the word inspirational. I don't actually think there's anything inherently inspirational about having had cancer, nor was it anything that any of us chose. But I do think that if sharing your story and sharing any part of it, whether it's the work you do or the volunteering that you do or your own sort of self-awareness inspires someone else to do something better or to do something good, that's something really, really to be proud of. And so I wanted to just end by sharing a quick story. You know, I remember, and truthfully, it still comes and goes sometimes. I mean, I have, as I mentioned, I have scars that run along my whole body. There are definitely things that still make me sort of hesitate when I share, but I remember feeling less than, and I remember feeling like cancer put me at a deficit, at a disadvantage in the workplace, in my social life, and in every which way. And one of my friends who received a Samfund grant many years ago and has become a dear friend ever since wrote a blog post for our Samfund website. And I lost track of it when we merged. So I have to, I'll share it with you, Catherine, so that if anyone's interested in reading it, I will find it somewhere. But it was our most highly read blog post of all time. And what she wrote about was tips for bringing survivorship to the workplace. And it wasn't, you know, sort of abstract, cancer changed my perspective and I'm a great person now and all this kind of stuff. It was making young adults, especially who were new to all of this, not only feel valuable, but feel marketable. And I remember she talked about things like having complicated medical care and needing different teams of doctors, you know, at different times. And so her punchline was, I'm not afraid to multitask. And I'm not afraid to talk to my superiors when the chief of service came in and, you know, I had to talk to him or her about whatever it was that was happening that day. And she translated it into job skills. She recontextualized her cancer experience, claimed control over it, and used it to her advantage. And so there are so many things that all of us have been through that give us value in ways we probably couldn't anticipate. And so I hope that this has been helpful. I hope that you will stand tall and stand proud in your stories, whatever they might be. And if you choose not to pursue any sort of cancer-related work or volunteer activities, that's okay too. I know plenty of people who have closed that chapter and, you know, whether it's temporary or permanent, they go forward on a different path. Having those choices and being able to claim control again over what our story is and how it gets told is pretty empowering. And I hope that all of you feel that and find a way forward, because all of you are pretty amazing. And I hope we can open it up to questions and discussions and get to know each other a little better. But thank you.
I'm going to clap for everybody and then some.
Thank you so much.
We see claps going up in the screen. I don't know how many times I wanted to cry. Sam, you're just amazing in your journey, and thank you for sharing with us. There were a number of questions and things that I want to bring up too and hear a little more about. But some people really kind of latched on the job stuff, and you didn't have a job when you were diagnosed, but one of the questions was, how did you go about bringing up your diagnosis with your employer? And any advice, and you obviously have lots of advice around this, for someone who's considering doing this, do you have thoughts on that? Obviously, again, you were in school, but what do you recommend for people to think about in that?
So it's such a good question. And I think especially when you don't have any any past experience, right, with employment, it's a really scary thing to think about someone holding that against you. Legally, they're not allowed to. In practice, they do sometimes. The first thing I would recommend is go to Cancer and Careers. So their website, I think, is cancerandcareers.org. Hopefully I didn't screw that up, but if you Google it, you'll find them. They are an incredible resource for navigating this kind of stuff in terms of what employers are allowed to ask, what they're not allowed to ask, what you have to disclose or not. They also have a really incredible way of leveling the playing field. So I heard, and I can't remember who it was, it was many years ago, but I heard someone from Cancer and Careers talk about the gap on a resume, right? So if you have been working, you take time off for treatment, and then you're coming back to work, I mean, it's sort of the elephant in the room, right, on an interview. And one of the things she said was, by the way, unemployment is at an all-time high right now. So everybody has a gap on their resume. And I think when cancer feels like the most important thing, it isn't always, right? And there are ways to sort of normalize that conversation without having to disclose. So I think that's one thing. I also think it's really important to be educated if you are working and then go back to the same job, to be educated in what accommodations you can ask for. Because there are certainly things that fall under the ADA that if there are reasonable accommodations within a workplace that will make it easier for you to do your job. For example, having a chair at your desk so you don't have to be on your feet all day if you're dealing with fatigue, or being able to take periodic breaks, all of that you're legally entitled to do. And it's important to know what your rights are and to not be afraid to ask for it. So it definitely, I mean, we've heard stories of best practices and other sorts of things, but I think Cancer and Careers is the resource to check out for this. They are amazing. Their website is great. They have webinars and conferences and all sorts of stuff.
Thanks, Sam. And you have to call me Anne for this one. We're not that hierarchical, right? Especially because you're not afraid of calling doctors out when you need to. Catherine, did you want to chime in?
No, that was perfect. Cancer and Careers is always, and just so everybody knows, we always include their webinars in our monthly newsletter so that by reading that, you'll be updated on great opportunities that they have to learn more.
Yeah. And I would just add that I answered somebody's question who wanted to hear the story again. So remember that this will be posted on our website. So I put our website, the internal website, not the big Dana-Farber one. I put that in that answer. It's youngandstrong.dana/farber or -farber.org. I put it in that answer. And the reason I'm bringing it up now is because we have a whole section probably lifted straight from Cancer and Careers on managing the workplace, as well as with credit, of course, but managing the workplace, as well as how to tell people things around that and your legal rights. That's kind of a changing thing too, and can vary by the size of the employer you work for and things like that, because that's really, really tricky. The other thing that can be really helpful around that is your social worker. So if there is a social worker at your cancer center, which most places have at Dana-Farber, we have a great department. The social workers are really helpful, both with the softer parts of, you know, how do you have that conversation? How do you not get emotional? But also around some of the more practical aspects of that, you know, what's okay from a legal standpoint and things like that. All right, so more questions. So someone asked a very specific question about, and this is good, if you change jobs, do you have to disclose that you have advanced breast cancer or metastatic breast cancer? Can you be let go from a job for taking off work to get treatments? Can you be working and apply for Medicare or Medicaid with metastatic breast cancer? And then there's a bill in the House, HR 3183, and one in the Senate, S1312. This person might want to give us a lecture on this, to help MBC patients, I assume, people with MBC, get Medicare if this passes. What do you know about it, and what help can MBC survivors get? And I love that you called yourself a survivor, because I do too, and I think anybody living with cancer or beyond cancer is a survivor. So thank you for that important question. Sam, do you want to take a stab at that, recognizing that it, you know, we may not know all the answers?
So definitely, I do not know all the answers, but I know that not only is there cancer in careers, but there are also legal resources. So Triage Cancer is another one that I'll give a shout out to, because they, Joanna Morales and Monica Fozzie Bryant, they are both cancer rights attorneys. And so I think all of these questions, I certainly do not want to step out of bounds here and give the wrong advice, but I would absolutely point you to Triage Cancer, because they have resources on their website and also are always accessible via email. And they can answer these questions about, you know, the legal side of things and what you need to do. Because I think I just recently talked to a friend of mine who feels like he's being pushed out of his organization and had to take some time off for medical tests and stuff. Legally, they can't do that, right? But sometimes they find a way to do it. So I think, again, being educated, having the supports in place, and finally, with regards to the last piece of that, advocating. I mean, the way that change happens is through advocacy. And so I think I would love to learn more, and I will look into it after these on those two bills. Because supports and protections don't exist doesn't mean that they can't. And there are groups that are advocating. There are easy ways to get involved locally, you know, at the state level, nationally. And it's so important that all of us touched by cancer, whether it's you or someone you love, get involved, make your voice heard. And if a protection is not in place, go make it happen.
So Sam, that's a great answer. And I think giving specifics about this is, you know, we could get into hot water just because we could be a little wrong and mislead. I want to pick up on the thread of the $250,000 bill and the, you know, how that made you feel. You know, we recently, I'll tell everybody candidly, we were trying to get people to walk on our fundraising walk, and we sent out to all of our constituency saying, you know, join us if you want. It's a fundraiser, so nobody has to, of course, but like people always ask and they say they didn't know about it. And people joined up, which was great. But one person wrote in and basically said, essentially, how dare you ask me for money? I just got my big bills. And we were, oh, no, we don't mean to, you know, we felt terrible because, you know, I guess we're sending the bills, we're Dana-Farber. And at the same time, you know, we were kind of like, ooh, yeah, no, you don't need to walk. You don't need to, but walk with us free. You know, like we're trying to think of ways to make this person feel better. Obviously we can't pay her bills ourselves, but you know, how do you recommend for people to manage that when they get that kind of bill? And then how did you manage that with the people who were sending you the bills?
It's intimidating, scary for sure. It's intimidating because bill collectors are nasty. And we've had many, many interactions with them over the years through the Samfund, and they don't make it easy. I think there are a lot of steps that can be taken before that $250,000 bill arrives in the mail. And thankfully now there are so many more resources. And I know Dana-Farber has some incredible programs in place to help people budget and to help people anticipate what the costs are going to be, because a lot of the crises that we've seen come because people are blindsided. Nobody talks about this stuff. And so I also think it's a lot to expect of the person who was diagnosed, but that's why caregivers and loved ones in the room are so critically important, because for all of the people, you know, especially immediate family that are saying, what can I do? The answer is go talk to a financial navigator, go talk to a patient navigator, find out what your costs are going to be through your insurance company. It doesn't lower the cost necessarily, but it allows you to prepare in a different way. It allows you to budget maybe a little bit differently. It allows you to get on a payment plan. Cause I think there's still, you know, to your point, and there's still a lot of misunderstanding about how billing happens and sort of who gets paid and where it goes. And I think we're still hearing from people who say, well, I can't even go see my doctor for follow-up care because I have an outstanding bill. And if I don't pay that, they're not going to get paid, which is not at all how that works. But I think there's so much shame and so much fear in having these outstanding bills that patients don't want to talk about it. Providers are so busy. They don't, you know, you certainly don't have time to have extensive conversations, but there are people in the hospital that can. So I think making those connections is really important, you know, and I think, and I know that I spent close to 20 years providing financial assistance, grants are a Band-Aid. And that was one of the most gratifying and one of the most frustrating things that I did in all of those years, because what I would really like to do is lower the cost for people. But until that happens, I think, you know, to your point about the fundraising walk versus the outstanding bills and sort of clarifying how this all works. When I get a fundraising appeal for a particular program, when it doesn't feel like it's going to pay the operating expenses of this big giant hospital, then I am much more likely to donate or just to join in to be part of the community. I think, you know, unless the billing specialist who yelled at me was going to be on the same team, there's no reason not to do it, right? And I think there's so much smoke and mirrors around how all of this happens, but being really clear, if something is raising money for Young and Strong and here's what the money will be used for, you know, and that people, like you said, people don't have to fundraise or donate at all, but just join in the effort and feel part of the community. So I think the whole issue of billing, you know, it's so intimidating and it's so just confusing for people. Reaching out to those resources that can help you within the hospital and even outside, there are a lot of great organizations just to prepare for it and not necessarily panic quite as much when the bill comes in.
I will say, just anecdotally, in my own experience, sometimes hospitals just send a bill because they haven't heard from the insurance yet too. And you think, I had that too. And I called the hospital, I'm like, I should be covered for this. And they were like, and the insurance got the insurance on the call. And they were like, yeah, we'll cover that part. I was like, why didn't you send me a bill then? Why, you know, they send it to me. I don't know. Are they going to pay it back if they get paid by the insurance?
Probably not.
Yeah, probably not. It was a big one.
It's funny. I got a letter from collections one time, and it was this nasty letter about how I hadn't paid my bills and blah, blah, blah. And at the bottom, it showed a balance due of zero. And so I called the collect, and it was internal collections from the hospital. And so I called them and I was like, I got this letter, and I gave them my number. And she started in with me about how, you know, it was going to go to collections and all this bad stuff was going to happen. And I was like, just do me a favor, just read to the bottom of the letter that you sent me. And she did. And she saw the zero balance, and, you know, she kind of shook it off and, you know, laughed about it because it was such an arbitrary mistake, but it just as easily could have said $10,000 or $50,000 and been a mistake. And so I think, you know, making sure that you're understanding the bill, that it's already been run through your insurance. I think, I don't know what the current statistic is, but I know probably 5 or 10 years ago, 80% of hospital bills had an error in them, which, you know, is a problem, but also important for people to know, because when you get that bill in the mail, there's still a lot you can do about it. And I think the biggest thing when you get big bills in the mail is to call and get on a payment plan, because at least if you're paying $10 a month, $20 a month, $100 a month, you might be, it's sort of like student loans, right? You're going to be paying them from now until eternity, but they're not going to garnish your wages. They're not going to send you to collections. It's not going to damage your credit. And I think a lot of the damage that we see is because people just either ignore it, don't understand it, don't do anything about it. And then it comes back to bite them because there's this huge balance. They can't open a credit card. Their wages are garnished and all this terrible stuff. There are a lot of things. Again, best case scenario, we reduce the costs of cancer for patients. But until that happens, there are still ways to protect yourself and your financial health in the long run.
All right. So no turtling is the message. Communicate. All right. So there's a bunch of questions that I want to try and just have brief answers to. One of them is, you talked a bit about knowing your why, but how did you know your when? You know, and I think that leads to the kind of, you know, when did you start to feel better and able to kind of express yourself? Because looking at you 20 years later, you're amazing, but I'm sure you didn't feel so amazing, as you said, all along the way.
So thank you for saying that. You know, I think two things, and I'll keep it brief. The first is that I learned how to fake it. I think, you know, I certainly was not feeling all that confident when, you know, in the things I described before, interviewing for a job, going on dates, trying to make new friends, but I faked it. And, you know, if you fake it long enough, then you start to sort of feel more comfortable. You fake it till you make it, right? And I think, you know, part of me wants to laugh because it sounds really ridiculous, but I think it's actually a really good coping strategy because it was really hard, you know, as far as figuring out the when, it's one of those things that I sort of figured out in real time, right? And I had a really, really good friend who was my roommate, and we would go out to a bar on a weekend, and I had my security blanket in her, right? And then little by little, we would do that. And I would realize that, you know, nobody actually cared about the scar on my leg, or cancer didn't even come up in conversations sometimes. And so you know, I took things slow. I think the reason why I talked so much about being mindful of the timing and sort of being mindful in your headspace when you bring these things up is that you can't take it back, right? You can't go backwards. And so take your time. There is no rush to do this in any particular order or at any particular time. And fake it until you don't have to anymore.
All right. And a related question, this is a good one. Advice on coming out about your cancer history to friends and acquaintances who you don't see as often, but when you do catch up, you want to be open with them about what you've been up to. Obviously, this is relevant for when, you know, years ago for you, but what do you advise people around that? Because you shock people, right? Sometimes, and then they get upset and then it ruins the night. And you're like, wait, no, I'm doing okay.
You know, I think easing into it in a conversation is good. You don't want to drop a bombshell and then watch it explode in front of everybody. It might be a good practice to sort of have one other person in the room that knows what's coming. So if others don't know how to respond to it, they can kind of follow that person's lead. But I think if these are people that are important to you, that are friends and that love you and, you know, have supported you in other ways, it's going to be okay. I think sharing with people who, I don't know, who are acquaintances too soon, that can be a little dicey, right? But that's the difference between friends and acquaintances. And I think sharing with people who are genuinely going to want to know, because I guess think about it in reverse, flip the script for a second, right? If you had a friend that you had lost touch with, and then you found out many years later that they had gone through cancer treatment, I think most of us would probably feel pretty awful that we didn't know and couldn't support them. And so if these are people that are going to want to be in your corner, you have nothing to lose by telling them. And I think, again, you don't have to sort of let the floodgates open and share everything at once. But you know, you can take your time. And I have actually, well, you know what, in the discussion afterwards, I have one more story about what I shared with my now husband and how it ended up in the New York Times. But you know, I took it slow. I didn't throw every piece of my cancer story at him the second that I met him. So I think just think about how you would want to receive this information and make sure that you're having the conversation with people that you trust and that you value having in your life.
So let's finish with that very happy thought. Right. And there is a question somebody asked, if appropriate, and clearly you think it's appropriate. Could you tell us about how you met your partner and how you managed that cancer conversation with him?
I sure can. Which
ended up in the New York Times, we now know. So tell us about that.
That's the end of the story.
We're going to finish up, but this has been great. Go ahead.
So I met him on Match. I know there's like 7,000 other sites now, but at that time, Match was the one that everybody was using. And I think actually, if I remember, I probably had either a Samfund or some sort of cancer related work in my profile, you know, that I was volunteering at this or that. So I kind of put it out there to see if anyone was curious about it and would bring it up, but I didn't want to sort of throw it at a stranger all at once. So when I met Adam, you know, I think our first or second date, you know, he was very curious about the work that I was doing. And, you know, again, I sort of said, oh yeah, well, I got into this because I had cancer and, you know, now here's what I'm doing. It sort of fast forwarded through a lot. 6 months into our relationship, I decided it was time to tell him that I probably could not have kids the way he thought that most people do. And so, or the way most people do, and the way he was expecting if that's where we were headed. And I chose 6 months because I felt like I was invested enough that I needed him to know, but we weren't engaged or married. So if he did head for the hills, you know, the world wouldn't end. And so I said to him, just so you know, one of the things that, you know, came up from all of my treatment is that probably my fertility was impacted and probably, you know, we're sort of going to have to go an alternate route to parenthood if that's what we decide to do. And without missing a beat, he said, there are a lot of kids in the world that need a home. So a couple months after that, one of my doctors from Memorial was interviewed. He was an author on a study about childhood cancer survivors, and the New York Times called me just whatever, because I was one of his patients and they wanted to hear my story. And the woman who interviewed me was awesome. And it was totally comfortable and, you know, just didn't feel like an interview. And I shared that story. And then a week later, it ended up, I still have the Times article actually. And of course my whole family called. It's like, you have to marry that guy. But he was right.
I was thinking we should clone him. Can we clone him?
There are a lot of really good people out there. And I think that's what I meant. Like, trust your gut. You know, if there's someone that you feel like is worthy of knowing your story, trust your gut and go with it. Maybe it will end up in the New York Times, maybe it won't. But yeah, if we, you know, I'll talk if anyone's interested later about my kids too. We adopted them both. We dealt with the infertility path as well. And so yeah, someday I got to show them that article too.
All right. So now we're going to move on to the social. I would just add, Sam, you know, if someone heads for the hills, when you bring up your cancer diagnosis, especially after you've gotten to know them for a while, they are not worthy of your time. You dodged a bullet on that one, right?
Yep.